Hello everyone, Taylorson here and welcome to episode 11 of La Tour de France 2020. Today's stage is a 168km flat stage from that plage place to Poitiers. It's flat, like, that's all I can say about it. There's one categorised climb, it's a category 4, but I doubt you'll see Wellens in the breakaway going for that one. He won't mind if somebody else takes that. Yeah, it's pretty dull this stage. I'm not going to deny that. Let's see what the team director thinks of it.
The main thing to grasp today is that the route is flat and it harbours no particular difficulties. A sprint finish is more than likely. It'll be important to pick up maximum points in order to make up lost ground for the green jersey.
We don't have what it takes to be in the final sprint. If we want to make a showing, we'll have to be in the early breakaway. Have a good stage.
Before I jump into the briefing, if you haven't already, subscribe to the channel. And if you've not caught up on the rest of this series, do watch the whole series through because it'll make more sense as to what's going on. If you want, you can probably start on... When was the last stage that I did a intro of like what happened previously? Anyway, it will probably be linked in a card up there. I'll probably work this out post-com. However, yeah, I'd start on that episode and then just work your way through from there if you're new to the series, that is. And like the video if you go on to enjoy it. Yeah, on to the briefing. So once again, it is the same objectives as yesterday's stage. And it's Bonifazio wanting to be in the top 10 and Manzin not getting the top 20, but going into the breakaway to try. So, yeah, onto the stage.
Hello and welcome to all. On paper, it's difficult to work up much enthusiasm for today's stage. We should witness the oft-repeated plot of an early breakaway doing its utmost to withstand the return of the peloton.
So we are underway then, and we are not in the best position off the start. It looks like we're going to make it to the front before anyone attacks, though. So we're going to attack by ourselves off the front and see if anybody follows. So it doesn't seem as though anybody's following at the moment. And oh, there goes Kelderman. Kelderman has decided. And Valgren as well. Kelderman and Valgren are off the front. Valgren, for his second day in a row in the breakaway, it seems like. And Kelderman, it's an interesting choice of stage to break away on, considering that he's a climber. And Burkhart has also gone away as well. So I will skip to when something else happens, and we'll go from there. Well, we've just been caught, but that doesn't mean anything, as I'm going to go off the front again. I might not be in the best position energy-wise, but I think I can hold out with my blue gel that I'm just going to take now. So we're off the front. Kevin Retzer this time goes for it, and Dillier as well. He's also a man to remember from stage one, that infamous stage where Barbero took the win. It seems as if they're going to catch up with me now, which is useful because then I've got people to work with in the break and try and extend the advantage. So I will see you whenever something else happens. We might get caught, but we might not. It seems as if we're not, so I will see you at the intermediate sprint. 129km to go as we just round this right-hand corner now, and it looks like I'm going to make it to the front group. I'm going to get caught by this second group on the road, but I should be able to get behind them and catch up to the front group. It's Hermans and Haas, and I have done so. So, Valgren's just attacked off the front. That's worrying, but I should see you at the intermediate sprint unless anything horrendous happens. We'll see. 1.6km to go until the intermediate sprint, and I'm just going to hit the front now and force a bit of tempo so that I'm controlling this, and they're going for it now. I wonder why that is. It seems to be downhill. That's annoying, and I'm going to have to take this... That did not go to plan. That didn't go to plan at all, and that might have bottled my chances at getting back to the front group I've blown up now, and I'm going to join Hermans in the third group on the road. That really hasn't gone well, and now I'm not well positioned at all with Bonifazio, and that has got to be one of the worst intermediate sprint performances I have ever had. Fifth out of five in that front group with Manzin. And I don't think I got any points with Bonifazio. That's terrible. Oh no, I got two. They might be important. We'll see. But now it's time to get Manzin to the front group on the road. I will see you when that happens. Into the final few kilometers we go then, and it's Mike Tønnesen leading out for Dylan Groenewegen. He's on the front at the moment. However, he's beginning to get swamped by the Lotto train, and here's the UAE Team Emirates train led by Christoph putting in pace for Gaviria on the right-hand side. The Lotto Soudal train seems to be coming through quite nicely as well. This looks like a very good opportunity for Caleb Ewan. We're now on board with Pascal Ackermann, who launches his sprint now. Can he make it to the front? It's Ewan on the front, currently Viviani to his left. Ackermann coming all the way on the left-hand side. He's going to take it, surely, Ackermann. Oh, it was very close with Groenewegen on the line, I think. Or is Groenewegen in the... Groenewegen's in the green jersey, and that was a Lotto Jumbo rider. Or a Jumbo Visma, even. And that was very tight between Ackermann and, I would probably assume, Wout van Aert. Let's have a look at Wout van Aert's perspective then. And I think Ackermann's got that. We'll check the photo finish just for confirmation. But I believe Pascal Ackermann has beaten out Wout van Aert, or the Jumbo Visma rider. It could have been Tønnesen. It could not have been. Although that looked closer than it actually was. I think it's Ackermann. I'm going to assume it's Ackermann that took today's stage. Well done to him. And we'll see who took it on the podium. And it was indeed Pascal Ackermann of Borre-Hansgrohe that took the stage. It was a very close fight from the Jumbo-Visma rider. There's the photo of that finish again. But Pascal Ackermann, the German, takes today's stage. Once again, this is a sprint stage, so nothing will really happen in the yellow jersey for today. It stays with Jakob Fuglsang. But that's two photo finishes that we've had in a row. I thought Ackermann was clear when I first saw it, and then suddenly the Jumbo-Visma rider came flying down that right-hand side. Groenewegen stays in green for another day, despite, I don't think, being there in the sprint. I didn't see him in the green jersey. Was he in the green jersey today? I believe he was. But I didn't see him in the sprint. So it must have been Van Aert or Tønnesen, who was the Jumbo-Visma sprinter. And Tim Wellens stays in the Polkadot classification jersey. That's expected, because there was only one point on offer today. As I said in the intro, he lifts his arms high and he's got another trophy and some more flowers. And where's he going to put all of this? And finally, Bernal is in the white jersey. He's going to be looking forward to those mountain stages to try and put some time into Fuglsang and Roglic.
Done, lads. You rode a very good stage. Finishing in the top 10, even though the stage didn't suit us, is very satisfying.
So there is your stage classification. Pascal Ackermann wins the stage for Borre-Hansgrohe, the German sprinter, beating out Wout van Aert, who was the Jumbo-Visma rider on that right-hand side. Elia Viviani comes home in another podium place in third. Fernando Gaviria in fourth, and Giacomo Nizzolo in fifth. Kort Nielsen with a very respectable performance for EF in sixth, with Cobrelli seventh, Saro eighth, and Bonifazio of Our team, Direct Energy, in 9th, with Davide Cimolai in 10th. Michael Matthews, the winner of last stage, finished in 11th position, with Caleb Ewan in 12th. Quite interesting to see that Dylan Groenewegen is nowhere to be seen in those standings, not in the top 20 at all. And that really means nothing for the general classification standings. Jakob Fuglsang still in first, Roglic in second, Bernal third, and Pino in fourth. Tim Wellens still holds the Best Climber Classification Award in first, with Mollema second, Kalmajan third, and Roglic fourth. In the points classification, Dylan Groenewegen is still hanging on to that, with Valgren and Trentin now tied on points in second and third, both on 103, with Groenewegen on 122. Fuglsang drops one place to fourth on 96 points, with Viviani making his way up the standings, and same with Ackermann going up 27 positions. Viviani on 93 points, Ackermann on 92 points. Dillier, after being in the break, is up to 7th, and Barbero down to 8th, with Bonifazio for us dropping one position down to 9th. In the young rider classification, Egan Bernal is still at the top of this one, with Evenepoel second, Pogacar third, Higuita fourth, and Gourdou in fifth. And finally, in the team classification, Ineos still leads that, from Astana and Jumbo Visma in second and third. Total Direct Energy are in eighth at 52 minutes and 46 seconds behind Ineos. Recovery, yet again, a full recovery for everyone apart from Manzin, who's really beginning to annoy me by not recovering, although that's probably my fault for sticking him in the breakaway as soon as a rest day comes along. And that is about it for today's video. Remember to like the video if you enjoyed it and subscribe to the channel if you are new here. Not very much else to say. In all honesty, I'm going to begin filming the second part of the No Gels experiment in a few days' time, so that will be coming soon, so there'll probably be another massive wait like last time. I promise I'll get better. But yeah, that is it. Stay safe, enjoy yourselves, and goodbye.